Tiffany Stankevich, and I would like to thank you for attending this talk today and inviting me to speak on optimal implantation solutions preparing a healthy and receptive endometrium. As a disclosure, I am the endometrial product director at iGenomics, which is part of the VitroLife group. So let's jump right into this talk. I'd like to share with a shocking statistic, I think, in my opinion, is that live birth rates following IVF today are still only 25 to 30% per started cycle worldwide. Now, we know that implantation is a significant rate limiting step in human reproduction and IVF. So, the implantation process itself hinges largely on two essential players, the embryo and the endometrium. So, for years, we have a focus on optimizing the embryo. This is evident with insemination techniques, so the introduction of intracytoplasmic sperm injection, for instance, optimizing our culture media, optimizing our incubators, optimizing our freezing techniques, moving from slow freezing to vitrification, which has much better survival rates, and introducing more advanced technologies such as PGT-A for aneuploidy screening. But even in advanced technologies such as PGT-A, we see that implantation failure still occurs about out of one of three of these cases. So for that reason, we need to look to the other player, which is the endometrium. Now, it's obvious looking at the periconceptional space that the endometrium is an integral part of implantation. From the moment that the embryo encounters the endometrium, it's going to encounter the endometrial microbiome or the bacteria living within the endometrium. From there, maternal embryonic crosstalk needs to occur between the implanting blastocyst and the endometrium itself. Endometrial receptivity is important since an implanting blastocyst can only implant into a receptive endometrium. And then, if this all goes well, hopefully we have good sigilization and placentation. So, for today's talk, we're going to focus on the endometrial microbiome and endometrial receptivity. So, since the endometrial microbiome is the first introduction that the embryo has to the endometrium, this is where we're going to start. So, the Human Microbiome Project was launched in 2008, and this highlights the importance of different microorganisms such as bacteria and their genomes in human health and disease. Identification of dysbiotic or pathogenic microbiomes may be key to improving clinical outcomes in various areas of medicine, including IVF. Some fun facts: humans have 10 times more bacteria than human cells in our body. In a person weighing 70 kilograms, approximately 1 kilogram is made up of bacteria. A high abundance of bacteria is found especially on the skin and digestive tract. And between 20 to 60% of this bacteria, depending on their location, are not culturable under standard laboratory conditions. Now, bacteria present in the urogenital tract make up 9% of the total human microbiota, and most of them are not easy to culture. A normal vaginal microbiota is defined as the presence of bacterial species of the Lactobacillus genus that are commonly associated with a healthy genitourinary status. The vaginal microbiota typically changes throughout the menstrual cycle, and these changes can lead to several pathologies that could have implications for both reproductive and obstetric processes. Now, we know that the microbiota is a continuum throughout the female reproductive tract, where we see in the vagina, it's mostly composed of lactobacillus and has a very high biomass. Now, this biomass is going to decrease as you move up to the ovaries. However, the diversity of bacteria present is going to increase. Now, recent research has identified the existence of an endometrial microbiome and has demonstrated that dysbiosis of the uterine cavity is associated with poor reproductive outcomes in assisted reproductive treatment patients. So let's look here at the first figure on the left. What we did in this earlier study back in 2016 is that we took endometrial fluid and vaginal aspirates from the same woman at the same time. And what we found was that the endometrial fluid contained bacteria that wasn't present in the vaginal aspirate, and vice versa. So this showed that the endometrial microbiome was unique and not just simply carried over from the vagina. So we now know that the endometrium bacteria should be there, and it's not sterile as we had once assumed. Now, we went on to look at the endometrial microbiome and subsequent reproductive outcomes in patients. And what we found was that women with a high presence of lactobacillus, as signified by the blue color here, and very little other bacteria, particularly pathogens, had a higher associated live birth rate versus those women with poor reproductive outcomes. These women, you can see, had much lower levels of lactobacillus, again, the blue color, and much higher presence of other bacteria, particularly pathogens, such as Gardnerella, as signified by the red color. In fact, bacteria such as Gardnerella, Streptococcus, and Staphylococcus were associated more strongly with poor reproductive outcomes. Now, in the same paper in 2016, we went on to perform a pilot study in which it suggests that pathogenic variations of the endometrial microbiome could play a role in infertility. So here, 32 patients underwent a personalized embryo transfer as guided by the ERA for receptivity. And we divided it based upon their endometrial microbial constituents at time of endometrial biopsy. And we had a lactobacillus-dominated group where we saw primary lactobacillus, so 90% or more, and very little or to no pathogens. And then we had a non-lactobacillus-dominated group where it was less than 90% lactobacillus, and the presence of other bacteria was there. And what was found that there was a significantly higher pregnancy rate, implantation rate, ongoing pregnancy rate, and live birth rate per transfer in the lactobacillus dominated group versus the non-lactobacillus dominated group. We also saw a difference in miscarriage rates between the two groups, although this was not statistically significant. So, in the group that had a high presence of lactobacillus, a miscarriage rate of 16.7% was observed. Whereas the group with a lower level of lactobacillus and higher presence of other bacteria, including pathogens, had a 60% miscarriage rate. So not only does it appear that the presence of pathogens associate with poor implantation failures, but also poor maintenance of pregnancy as far as increased miscarriage rates. Now, there have been other groups that showed that Lactobacillus is the most abundant genus in the endometrium. So I think it's clear that we know that the endometrium is not sterile as we had once assumed. And I think a great way to show the effects of the endometrial microbiome on reproductive outcome is to highlight a case report that I share here. Now, this is from the same patient. And we had endometrial fluid taken in the cycle that led to the miscarriage versus endometrial fluid that was taken when the patient was 4 weeks pregnant. So it was unbeknownst to both the patient and the provider at the time that she was actually very early in pregnancy. But this gave us the first glimpse of the endometrial microbiota in early pregnancy. And we can really see a difference between the bacterial profiles in the miscarriage versus the pregnancy. So, in miscarriage, we have very low presence of lactobacillus, as signified by the dark magenta color, and a high presence of other bacteria. We can see a lot of diversity here, particularly with pathogens. Now, when we look at the microbiome at time of pregnancy, we can see quite the opposite. So, a very high presence of lactobacillus and very low presence of other bacteria was here. So I think this is just a beautiful example within the same patient how the microbiome can really affect reproductive outcome. Now, I think the best example of pathology caused by an altered endometrial microbiome is chronic endometritis. This is something that we're all well aware of, which is the persistent inflammation of the endometrial lining, mainly caused by bacterial infection with common pathogens that include Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, Enterobacteria, Enterococcus, Mycoplasma, and Uroplasma. Now, patients are usually asymptomatic and thus seldom diagnosed and treated. The prevalence rates are estimated to be anywhere between 0.8 to 19% in the general population, 30% in the infertile patients, and upwards of 60% in recurrent implantation failure and repeated pregnancy loss groups. Chronic endometritis may influence the reproductive function, decreasing success rates in ART and increasing obstructive complications. And we know that it's not detectable by ultrasound. So the gold standard for diagnosis has been histology, though hysteroscopy and microbial culture have also been classically used. And the most frequent treatment is antimicrobial therapy with broad spectrum antibiotics. So this is what we need to focus on here, just to keep in mind broad spectrum antibiotics, and we'll see why in the next slides. Now, as I said, three classical methods used have been histology, hysteroscopy, and microbial culture. However, these methods provide inconclusive or misleading results in about 80% of cases. So while we see that histology tends to underdiagnose the disease, hysteroscopy tends to overdiagnose chronic endometritis. Now, microbial culture, to some degree, does allow for objective diagnosis. But however, since between 20 to 60% of bacteria cannot be cultured under standard laboratory conditions, we can sometimes see false negatives being reported. So this is really where molecular assessments such as the Emma and Alice test shine, because it allows for an objective result so we can see which bacterial DNA is present in the endometrial biopsy sample, which allows for a more targeted antibiotic treatment versus what I mentioned before, the use of broad spectrum antibiotics, which may not even target the bacteria present in the endometrium, not to mention, leading toward antibiotic-resistant bacteria. So I think we need to all do our part, not only to optimize a patient's microbiome more effectively, but also reduce the use of broad spectrum antibiotics. Now, on top of this, the molecular platform can do something beyond microbial culture in that it can detect bacteria, even those that are not able to be cultured. So we see less false negative rates when we consider this. On top of that, we have a very short turnaround time with a molecular method versus something like microbial culture, where we need to rely on the bacteria to grow and to proliferate. With molecular, it's a matter of hours in order to see the bacterial DNA present. Now, I mentioned a few times the EMMA test. So EMMA stands for Endometrial Microbiome Metagenomic Analysis, and this is a molecular assay that's used to determine whether the uterine microbial environment is optimal for implantation. So this is based on detecting and measuring the amount of DNA present in endometrial samples. So here we looked at four species of Lactobacillus. So again, Lactobacillus is a good bacteria. They act as a safety net to prevent the bad bacteria pathogens from growing. We look at reproductive tract pathogens. And then we also look at chronic endometritis causing bacteria. And this we refer to as our ALIS test. So ALIS specifically looks for chronic endometritis, where EMMA is a full microbial view that includes ALIS. Now, I like to bring this, I want to introduce this is a recent ESHRE good practice recommendation for RAF. And what we see here is that EMMA and ALIS can be recommended for patients suffering from RAF to investigate chronic endometritis, because chronic endometritis, as mentioned, has been associated with RAF and RPL groups. So again, an intervention, or I should say investigation, that is part of the ESHRE good practice recommendation. Now, what do we do when we find pathogens present in the endometrium? How can we ensure proper treatment? And I think we went over the fact that, broad spectrum antibiotics are not always going to be the most effective route. So I would like to share with you a recent publication from a group in Japan led by Dr. Iwami. And here, what they were doing is determining if the analysis of endometrial microbiome and its recommended treatments have positive impacts on pregnancy rates in patients with RAF. So this was a prospective cohort study in a single center from Japan that included 195 women with RAF. They used the EMA test in order to analyze endometrial biopsies. And the primary outcome here was cumulative clinical pregnancy rate after two additional ETs. Now, what they found was that one in four patients needed antibiotics to treat a pathogen detected on the EMA test. And 90% of the antibiotics administered in this study were not broad spectrum, but are instead targeted to the specific pathogens detected. Again, this is the advantage with a molecular technique such as EMA. And they compared the study group, which was those patients who underwent the EMA test and corresponding antimicrobial treatment, versus the control group who did not undergo any microbial testing. And what they found was significantly higher HCG positive rate, clinical pregnancy rate, ongoing pregnancy rate, and delivery rate in those patients who underwent microbial testing and any subsequent treatment versus those patients who did not go under any treatment. So I think the conclusions here is that the vaginal endometrial microbiome are different. Lactobacillus is the most abundant genus in the endometrium. A lactobacillus dominant endometrium is associated with better reproductive prognosis in IVF patients. The presence of pathogens in the endometrium is associated with implantation failure, recurrent miscarriage, preterm birth. And the endometrial microbiota composition before embryo transfer could be a useful biomarker to consider, offering an opportunity to further improve diagnosis and treatment strategies. So now moving on to the other topic, which is endometrial receptivity. Now, we know that there are various changes occur throughout the menstrual cycle, where we see varying biological functions activated accordingly. Now, it's important to remember that the embryo can only implant in the endometrium with a receptive phenotype, as indicated by the window of implantation that occurs during the mid-secretory phase. Now, in most women, this is going to be between days 19 to 21 of the menstrual cycle. Now, homing in on the window of implantation further, this was first proposed in the mid-1950s, where various lengths have also been proposed since then. So earlier studies suggested that the window of implantation lasted about 10 days. Later studies suggested 2 days. And now molecular studies are suggesting an average window of implantation duration of 29 to 36 hours. Now, we can all agree that the window of implantation concludes upon the initiation of stromal cell decidualization, subsequently permitting trophoblast invasion and placental formation. Now, we ask ourselves, when is the best time to transfer an embryo in IVF cycle? And we should not ask not if, but again, when is the best time? So typically, we transfer after 5 full days of progesterone exposure in an HRT cycle. This would correspond to about 7 days from LH surge or HCG trigger in a natural cycle, because again, this would equate to approximately day 19 and 21 of the days with the where the window of implantation lies in most women in natural menstrual cycles. So, what has been the standard endometrial preparation for IVF transfer? Well, we assume that the window of implantation is constant in all women, which of course now we know that is not to be true. We have to consider the effects of supraphysiological steroid levels and controlled ovarian stimulation cycles and the potential deterioration of endometrial receptivity. That's why usually if we see high endogenous progesterone levels, prior to HCG trigger or retrieval, this usually will yield the need for an all-freeze cycle. We monitor hormone levels, so standard would be estrogen and progesterone. And then I would say probably all of us look at the assessment of endometrial thickness by transvaginal ultrasound. We want to see a nice thickness of the endometrium around 6 to 12 millimeters prior to progesterone administration. Now, there have been methods of inducing or finding receptivity that include endometrial scratching, though in the Cochrane review, this shows that's not a very effective technique. Histological dating has been used in the past, so have biochemical markers. Now, probably the most advanced technology is going to be utilizing transcriptomics, which is the study of full range of messenger RNA or mRNA molecules expressed from genes or organisms. The analysis of gene expression patterns in particular tissues under distinct conditions allows not only for diagnosis of pathological conditions such as cancer, but also physiological processes such as endometrial receptivity. And a prime example of this would be the ERA test or endometrial receptivity analysis, the original endometrial receptivity test in IVF. And here it analyzes by NGS or next generation sequencing the expression of 248 genes related to endometrial receptivity, determine the optimal day for embryo transfer for each specific patient. So this allows for an actionable directive for a more personalized approach to embryo transfer and provides enhanced synchrony between an implanting embryo and a receptive endometrium. So the ERA test itself is supported by over 30 publications, but the main indication is recurrent implantation failure. And I'd like to share some studies here with you. So this was an earlier study back from 2013 in which we looked at the receptivity rates between RAF patients and control. And we see that about 1 in 4 RAF patients have a displaced window of implantation, where our control group, which were patients without RAF, had a displacement rate of only about 12%. Now, what was interesting here is that when we adjusted the window of implantation based upon the patient's personalized time of receptivity, the RAF had similar outcomes to those of the control group. So again, we were showing that for many of these patients with RAF, it was just simply finding their personalized window of implantation and personalizing transfer based upon this timing. I like to also share another case report. I think these are very profound and highlight highlight the advantages or the biological processes backing these tests. So in this particular case, the patient had underwent 7 failed cycles. You could see fresh, frozen, HRT natural, even 3 of them using oocyte donation, and always had a failure. Now, she did undergo the ERA test, was found to be displaced by 2 days, transferred on P plus 7, so about 168 hours of progesterone exposure. 2 embryos were transferred, and she had successful twin pregnancy and live birth. So again, just further highlighting how important endometrial receptivity and personalizing embryo transfer can be for some patients. In a recent publication, again, looking at RAF patients, a group wanted to assess RAF patients who underwent ERA versus those who went under traditional FET, in which they found significantly higher implantation, pregnancy, and clinical pregnancy rates in patients who underwent a personalized embryo transfer versus a standard embryo transfer. And then there have been recent meta-analysis, again, showing the benefit in patients with RAF. So one from Liu et al. In 2022, showing that PET guided by ERA significantly increases the chance of pregnancy for non-receptive patients with RAF and endometrial origin. A more recent meta-analysis from earlier this year by Glojewski et al. They showed that in women with RAF, PET might improve the clinical pregnancy rate. And then just about a month ago, there was a meta-analysis comparing the effectiveness and safety of 36 therapies or interventions for pregnancy outcomes with recurrent implantation failure, in which ERA was one of the 36 therapies assessed. in which it showed improvement for implantation rate, live birth rate, and when used with PGTA, reduced miscarriage rates. Additionally, this year at ESHRE, it was presented improved outcomes in patients with one or more failed transfers, where we saw a significantly higher pregnancy rate, ongoing pregnancy rate, and live birth rate versus patients who underwent a standard embryo transfer. And then more internal data, again, showing significantly improved outcome with the addition of personalized embryo transfer with euploid embryo transfer following PGTA. So again, ESHRE good practice recommendation for RAF also showed that ERA can be recommended to patients suffering from RAF to investigate endometrial function. And then to further solidify, our group is this year launching a multi-center prospective non-selection study for endometrial receptivity analysis in patients with previous implantation failures. So we are looking forward to starting this very large endeavor and to have the results hopefully sooner than later to share with everyone. And conclusions here, because I'm running out of time, is that endometrial factor plays a key role during the implantation process, and we cannot always solely rely on embryo for success. Although most women are receptive at the standard window of implantation, some of them reach receptive phenotype earlier or later, showing a displaced window of implantation. And to increase the probabilities of getting pregnant, it's important to synchronize a competent blastocyst with a receptive endometrium through personalization of embryo transfer. So I hope to show you that a healthy and receptive endometrium is indeed at the heart of implantation. So thank you again, for allowing me to speak today and for your attention.